Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. A few announcements before we begin, so if you would follow along, please, on your announcement sheets. Next week, Pastor Bill Fillmore will be here leading the ministry of the word and preaching and worship, so he will be here, and he's looking forward to it. He wanted to say thank you for letting him come, and he's a good guy, and he's now officially retired, but he's looking forward to being here next week, and he's going to spend a little time on 2 Peter 3. I'm not sure if I got that in the announcement for, I didn't. 2 Peter 3, verses 17 and 18, he's going to talk about what does it mean to grow in the grace and knowledge of Christ that for next week. So he'll be here. Welcome him, and we will be on vacation, going to go see Adeline. She's going to swim at Annapolis, so we're going to go there. That's going to be kind of fun, so. Also, over on the other side, Trunk or Treat, Operation Christmas Child, West Shore Family Support. There's two for Operation Christmas Child. Remember, the postage is expensive, so keep that in mind. We're working towards getting some more fundraisers for that. A ladies' luncheon, October 18th at 1 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. Keep that in mind. And then also today, we start Heidelberg Catechism classes for all ages. So I hope to see a nice blend of demographics, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. But anyway, it should be fun, and we'll learn a lot from the catechism. I think that is it. We have one announcement from Johan.
Thank you. Hi, morning. Just want to say that today is Pastor Appreciation Day. So thank you, Ben. We know it took quite a bit to get a pastor, and then a pastor was actually, you know, you felt that it was a real calling, and we appreciate that. And the guys that did the looking for a pastor also felt that this was the right person for the calling. So we thank you. We know it's been difficult with what we're going through. It will probably be a little bit difficult yet, but we just need to stick with that.
I've been through much worse.
Okay, good. And then, by the way, there will be some cake and whatever after we're done. So I just want to say thank you, Ben.
Thanks. Yeah, just a note before we go to God's call, calling us to worship. It is difficult. We're making a big change. There's a lot of stresses with it. There's also some identity issues that we're trying to work through, which stresses us out, but as a pastor, one of the things that God does through the whole process is beats out of you as a minister being surprised by what congregations will do. And so it hasn't been terrible. It hasn't been, you know, I've been through worse, so please don't make it worse. Don't try to set that new mark. But it's just a hard thing we're trying to do. And when you follow God's word and you're trying to be faithful to it, it comes at a cost. And that's, I hope you've heard that from me. It's happened to me in the ministry. I've been chased out of congregations before for doing that, but we're trying to follow God's word the best we can, and it's not going to be perfect, but let's have some cake together. And it's, by the way, Johan, it's not just one day. It's supposed to be a whole month. So even if I'm out here next week, there should be cake too, right? So yeah. Anyway, let's change our hearts and minds. Thank you for that, and let's have a little cake after and celebrate. It's really hard to talk about the Sabbath and read something about how we find rest in Christ. So there's a complicated passage in Hebrews that I'm going to read a little bit from. It's in Hebrews 3, and it talks about entering Christ's eternal rest. What is that, and how does that apply to us as New Testament believers, knowing that we have this commandment that says, you will keep the Sabbath day, okay? Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you he found to have fallen short of it. For we also have had the good news proclaimed to us just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. Now we who have believed enter the rest just as God said, and yet his works have been finished since the creation of the world. For somewhere he has spoken about the seventh day in these words. Where has he said this? On the seventh day, God rested from all his works. And again, the passage above, he says, they shall never enter my rest, those who don't believe. So what does it mean to enter in Christ's rest? This is what we're going to explore today. So let us quiet our hearts and minds. People of God, the Lord of the eternal Sabbath greets you this morning. He greets you with his love and his mercy and his rest. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. As the Lord has greeted us, let's take a moment and greet each other.
We're going to worship. Just lift our voice in song. Here we go. Thank you. Lord, thank you for gathering us here this morning. As the song has just stated, our sins are many. There are so many times we turn from you intentionally, we turn from you unintentionally. We just get lazy in the culture and in the world. Lord, this morning, remind us of why you saved us. Remind us of your Son. Remind us of the gift of his sacrifice to save us from our sins. We are here to worship you. We are here to praise. We are here to open your word and to learn and to grow. Lord, help us to be committed to you this morning.
So a couple of prayer requests. Tom is going to have surgery, Tom Beckman, on Tuesday, so we'll lift him up, knee replacement. Lee, what's the latest with Lee? He had surgery yesterday. Do you have any updates, Gene? Okay. So, but the surgery went fine? Okay. All right. So we'll pray for him. And then... praise. Linda didn't make it in, right? Linda Vinette. She called me on Thursday and is just doing marvelously well. So there are a couple of things with her leg, right? She had a rod that had to be removed, and then they had to do her hip, and all of that went, it was less invasive than they thought. Everything went well. She's out actually walking and doing physical therapy, so praise Lord for that. So I put that there under the praise. And then what's the latest with your uncle?
Uncle's numbers are slowly improving. They put him on some different anti-rejection medication that seems to be helping.
Okay.
And the numbers are going up in a positive direction.
Okay. So there was some rejection of the kidney and some of the medication issues. So we're going to pray for that as well. So let's go to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to gather and worship. Lord, thank you for all your mercy towards us. We know mercy is for those who are sick and need healing. And Lord, do we need healing from all of our sins, from all of our idolatry, from all of our waywardness. But you also give us grace. Grace is for those who deserve eternal punishment. And you give us your undeserved favor, grace. And so, Lord, without any of that, we could not be here. Without your calling and without your mercy and your grace, your faithfulness, and your love, we would be destitute. And so, Lord, we come before you to cleanse ourselves, to once again hear the assurance that we have in Jesus Christ, that because of him, we have eternal rest. And as we think about how busy we are in this crazy earthly life, we run around, sicknesses, our schedules are busy, meetings, and we feel like we can't even get a breath. Lord, you have provided us a rest that will cure our souls and make us new in you. That the forgiveness of sins will be so complete that we won't even have a desire to sin. Thank you, Lord, for the hope that we have, for the love given, for the blessings and the promises that are before us. Help us to grasp those and run the race for that rest. Lord, we live in a broken world, and we have a variety of prayer requests this morning, Lord. We pray for Scott's uncle, his uncle John. He has gone through a lot with this kidney transplant, and there's been rejection going on with his body. So I just pray, Lord, that you would provide healing so that kidney would work and the medicines would all align so that there is no rejection. We also pray for Lee. We ask, Lord, that you would keep the surgery that he had free from infection and that he'd be able to adjust with all the rehab, and losing part of your leg is a big, big change for him. So we ask, Lord, that you would help him with that as he adjusts, and pray for the family as well, for Judy as she has to figure out what that care looks like, and their whole life is going to be changed from this. Lord, we also pray for Sharon, who is dealing with some serious back pain and is trying to prevent some surgery. We ask, Lord, that you would make that PT really effective and they would find a way to help her with her spine. We also pray for Debbie, Lord, grant her wisdom as she gets ready for a consultation on the 23rd and to figure out where the doctors want to go with this procedure for her eye. We ask, Lord, that you would be with them and that your hand would be guiding their hands as they and their minds about what's best for her to save her eye. We also pray for Tom as he gets ready for knee replacement coming up. We ask, Lord, that it would go well and that you would give him strength. I pray, Lord, that you would keep him free from infection, and Lord, that the rehab would be not so painful, but able to get through it, and really the pain would be minimized for him. And we offer a praise, Lord, two praises. Thank you for Linda's great report this week. It was a big thing that happened for her, and there's a bunch of healing that's gone on, Lord, and I thank you for that, not only just physically, but also spiritually. And Chris McPhail reported that his brother-in-law is doing much better this week, and we thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Father, we thank you for this time of gathering together as your people to sing praises to you, to hear your word preached, to pray to you, and to be your people in fellowship. Lord, thank you for inclining your ear towards us, and thank you for this time. We pray all of this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. It is now time for our offering, and it is for the general fund. Can I have deacons come forward, please?
For this next song from Psalm 130. It's the idea of waiting on the Lord.
Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your
Lord, as we open your word, is our prayer right now that we can be blessed by it, we can also be challenged by it, that we can find what you want us to hear, what you want us to grow in knowledge. Lord, thank you for Pastor Ben. Thank you for his leadership in this church. Thank you for his sacrifice to this church and for his family's sacrifice to our church. And as we open the word, bless him. Bless the words that he shares, that you've put on his heart and mind, that we can be challenged. It's in your name that we pray.
So we finish out table one today, then we'll take a break. And then in 2 weeks, we'll start on table two, which is commandment five. Once again, Exodus 20, and we'll jump over to Deuteronomy. But what I changed this week is we're only going to look at the commandment in Deuteronomy. We're not going to read all the extra that went before it. But in Exodus, we will read all the commandments thus far and then focus on the Sabbath day commandment four. So it'll be projected. And then we have a Heidelberg Catechism reading after that. So beginning in chapter 20, verse 1 of Exodus. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. So why does God put that in there? He's claiming that he's their savior and deliverer. And he also is showing them the grace that's in these commandments. These are for you. These are special. And I am your deliverer and savior. Commandment number one, you will never have any other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. We spent some time on that when we went through that. That means improper worship can be handed down for generations. And so if we don't follow what God says to do in his word, then we don't love him, we hate him. So it's disobedience is what he's talking about. But showing love to 1,000 generations for those who love me or who obey my commandments. Commandment three, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. For the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. That's a pretty serious one. And then the fourth commandment. Notice that there's going to be a difference. Pay attention to the wording and the structure here in Exodus versus Deuteronomy. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Now over to Deuteronomy, beginning in verse 12. Notice the differences. Observe or guard the Sabbath day by keeping it holy as the Lord your God has commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your ox, your donkey, or any of your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns, so that your male and female servants may rest as you do. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt and that the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. Now let's go to the catechism. I didn't move my sticky notes, so let me do that now. You have the answer. I will read the question. What is God's will for you in the fourth commandment? First, and that especially the festive day of rest, I regularly attend the assembly of God's people to learn what God's word teaches, to participate in the sacraments, to pray to God publicly, and to bring Christian offerings for the poor. Second, that every day of my life I rest from my evil ways, let the Lord work in me through his Spirit, and so begin already in this life the eternal Sabbath. This is the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God. Now, question, do you see any demands in there for having a Sabbath day? Because this is our question, to Sabbath or not to Sabbath. It was January 21st, 2005, and I was reflecting on that. That's going to be 20 years ago that I was in basic Christian ethics. I was a foreigner in the land of tall Dutch people. That's been a whole thing to get adjusted to. You were all very tall. I made my way through the hallowed halls of Calvin Theological Seminary, still asking, why am I here, God? And I still ask that question every day. I was heading into basic Christian ethics, and we were traversing the deep caverns of the Ten Commandments. And this day, the lecture was on the fourth commandment, and little did I know what awaited me. The content of the lecture would shake the very foundations of my fellow CRC pastors in training. Now, what was stunning to me was the fear that came over these well-raised, well-educated, very intelligent Dutch men and Dutch women. There was others always. There's always a minority of non-Dutch in there, but it's mainly them, right? It became apparent that they had been trained to be Sabbath observers, strict Sabbath observers. So that meant pot roast had to be made on Saturday, right? And then on Sunday, if you were going to go to the lake, no more than over your ankles, right? And you certainly couldn't go out to eat because that was bad for your unbelieving neighbor who was obviously working on Sunday. Being new to the Reformed tradition and also the Dutch-American culture, this was all new to me, so I didn't have any idea about all this stuff. I was in a different place. I was excited to learn what the commandments meant. What's the exegesis behind it? What's the original text saying? I was excited about that and what the church is saying. But for my classmates raised in the CRC, the lecture on the fourth commandment almost created a crisis of faith. The professor pushed us. Do you really have to keep the Sabbath? He kind of had that smile on his face. He stated, I never worry about making sure the pot roast is made on Saturday evening. And the blood pressures either dropped or went right high. A storm was brewing. A good Reformed education was clashing with their family's held long traditional beliefs. To Sabbath or not to Sabbath. Maybe this is one of the problems. He's not too swift with most of the Ten Commandments, but he does rest on Sundays. What do we do with this? The clouds rumbled, the lightning flashed. Oh, what to do with this fourth commandment? This is fun. So what say you, brothers and sisters? Are we to hold a Sabbath day? What do you think? What does a Sabbath day look like for New Testament believers? Why or why not? If you are for a Sabbath, what are your reasons? And if you're against the old time Sabbath, why? You've got to have your reasons, right? Your biblical thoughts on it, passages that come to mind, and so forth. Remember this, all of our life is worship. Every moment, every minute, every second of our day is supposed to be worship, and it's not just one day. So let's set the stage a little bit here. I have to do a little bit of work in prepping us all before we get to the positive and negative forces here of the commandments. There's a lot of background here because this one, of all the commandments, Jesus changes this one the most. He expands all of them. So in other words, like, you will never murder. Okay, the action was the issue in the Old Testament. Jesus says, no, if you have anger in your heart, that's where murder starts. So he expands all of the commandments. This one, he really changes. So first we have to start off with what does Sabbath mean? It means not only the seventh day, but it also means rest. Now, when was the Sabbath for the Jewish mindset? It was Friday night to Saturday night. So even Dutch immigrants who really wanted to do Sabbath observance, they did it on the wrong day, right? So there's some interesting stuff there. Now, the law has many parts to it. So for example, there's a ceremonial part and a civil part, and then there's the moral part. Most of the ceremonial was taken care of through Christ's sacrifice. The atonement for sins and all of that was ceremonial, okay? Because you still had to have the circumcision of the heart. You still had to have faith. The civil part, which is what made Israel Israel as a nation in the Old Testament, is no longer valid either. So what we are obligated to is the moral part of the law. There is distinctions from the Old Testament into the New Testament. We are not concerned with the ceremonial, but we're concerned with the moral part of the commandment. Now, I want to show you something to have a little fun with this. I'm throwing the Westminster Catechism in there for a moment. This is about 80 years after the Heidelberg and after the peak of the Reformation. The Scottish really embraced Presbyterianism, and as the Reformation formed, it went further into Europe. And by the time you get to 80 years later, you have what there was a need to write the Westminster Catechism, long one, short one, and the Westminster Confession. Anyway, to save some time, I went to the shorter catechism, and I want you to hear this. See how this rubs up against the Heidelberg Catechism. So the question is, which day of the seventh hath God appointed to be the weekly Sabbath? Answer, from the beginning of the world to the resurrection of Christ, God appointed the seventh day of the week to be the weekly Sabbath, and the first day of the week ever since to continue to the end of the world, which is the Christian Sabbath. Does that resonate with you? Does that make sense for Sabbath? So in other words, there was this Sabbath, but then we have now this Christian Sabbath, which is on the first day of the week on Sunday. The Westminster is teaching a special day. Now, here's what's interesting about history. The first 300 years of the church, they never taught that. There was no such thing as a Sabbath after Christ was resurrected and ascended. Why is that? There was no Sabbath observance. Now, Andrew Kuivenhoven, who is he's now gone, he's now with the Lord. He was a CRC minister, but also wrote for the Banner for a long time. He has a commentary on, I don't think I put this in here. Nope. Hold on, I'll get to that in a second. Kuivenhoven says this in his commentary on the Heidelberg. Most Calvinists were reared according to Sabbath observance, but the confessions do not officially teach Sabbath observance. Whoa. What does that mean? You see the conundrum here, right? This is what I was observing in the classroom because I had no idea even how to read the commandments. I was in a whole different place, right? So this is what it gets down to. The Heidelberg doesn't teach specific days. It teaches the affirmative of the commandment. We worship God, promote such worship all the days of our lives and be done with the evil in our lives and enjoy the spiritual time. So here's the real shocker. Dutch immigrants are more Presbyterian when it comes to their Sabbath observance than they are Reformed. And that's part of the interesting thing of how history and context all blend together. And then, you know, we hold on to these things, even though we may be wrong. That's why you always have to go back to the Word. And what's interesting is, what would future generations say about us? What are we holding on to that's foolish? And we can let go and don't need to fight over, but we do. Every generation has that. The power of the culture is there. So in Sabbath observance, Dutch immigrants came as Presbyterians, even though they wanted to be Dutch Reformed. Isn't that ironic? Now let's talk a little bit about the differences, some of the grammar here in Exodus 20, verse 8, and Deuteronomy 5. So in Exodus, you have remember. And he ties it back to Genesis chapter 2. Remember that God made the heavens and the earth, and he rested on the seventh day. So there's a creational connection there, right? What's interesting about that is it means this. Why is the Sabbath day holy? Because when God made creation, it was good, and he wanted to enjoy it. Here's a question that's left outstanding. What happens to creation after the fall? Ah, that changes things, okay? Deuteronomy. Notice the difference. It says observe and guard. So God commanded rest. Remember the Lord's deliverance. So this one answers why we ought to keep the commandment. You get to work all the other days. Now let God work on you. This is why we do this, okay? Couple of key phrases here. There's a lot more I could say, so I am cutting it down. I know sometimes I'm wordy, but I'm really cutting out a lot. During 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. 6 days you shall labor and do your work. You see those slight differences here, and the focus is trying to get them to focus on God's work in their life. That's what the Sabbath observance was. Now, it's our work versus God. I should have put God's work in our life. I had that in there and I took it out. And now as I read it out loud, I realize it's better to have our life in there. But I don't want it to be about us and our selfishness. It's God's work in your life over your whole life, how he works in your family, how he does over generations. That's what Sabbath keeping was about. Isaiah says the following. This is really interesting. If you keep your feet from breaking the Sabbath and from doing as you please on my holy day, so there is the rub. If you call the Sabbath a delight and the Lord's holy day honorable, and if you honor it by not going your own way and not doing as you please or speaking idle words, then you will find your joy in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride in triumph on the heights of the land and to feast on the inheritance of your father Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. So, does God need to rest on the seventh day? Why does he rest? To enjoy his creation. He doesn't fatigue, right? So that's why the Israelites were supposed to do that. So they Sabbath for two reasons. They're following God's example and they were to enjoy God's creation. It's not all work, 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 right? That's number one. But then, as you just heard me say, they're focused on God and his work in them. How has God worked in their life? So that's the Old Testament. Now, we're still building, we're still setting the stage here. One last thing. John Calvin on the Sabbath. This was a real doozy when he quoted this out of the Institutes. This was a fun moment in class 20 years ago. First, so why does he have the Sabbath? Why the Sabbath? First, to furnish the people of Israel with a type of spiritual rest by which believers were to cease from their own works and allow God to work in them. Secondly, a stated day in which they should assemble to hear the law and perform religious rites and also be trained in piety. And thirdly, he meant that servants and those who lived under the authority of others should be indulged with a day of rest. So think about how contrary that would be to those who had slaves all around them in the culture who never gave their slaves a day off. They worked them to death, right? But not at Israel. Israel was special and different and unique because the Lord, their God. So, are we supposed to keep the Sabbath? To Sabbath or not to Sabbath? What do you think? So let's go to some New Testament passages. In Mark 2, this is a passage I had in here that I took out because I thought it'd go too long. In Mark 2, 23 to 38, Jesus and his disciples are going along and they're plucking the heads off the grain in the fields to eat. Right? To a Pharisee, oh boy, that is breaking the Sabbath. That is work. I mean, you are in there, right? And Jesus' response to them is what? Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So what had happened in concern for keeping the Sabbath in the Old Testament, the Sabbath became an idol. And it was so important that it was at the expense of human beings. And it wasn't supposed to be that way, okay? Also the same in Matthew 12. I don't know which one I put up here. Matthew 12, Luke 6. They have, oh, there it is right there. There's an opportunity in the New Testament for Jesus and his disciples to affirm keeping the Sabbath day, but they don't. Now, a couple of other ones. Colossians, let me read this one for you. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. They are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. And we attended a Presbyterian church for a while, and when the pastor got to this passage, he's saying, oh yeah, is Paul saying you shouldn't observe a Sabbath day? Yes, he's saying that. It doesn't really matter because the reality is in Christ. Galatians 4, formerly when you did not know God, you were slaves to those who by nature are not gods. But now that you know God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you're turning back to those weak and miserable forces? Do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? You're observing special days and months and seasons and years. Paul says, I fear for you that somehow I have wasted my efforts on you. And then Romans 14, I think I have this one up here. I put this one to kind of round it out. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers every day alike. Each of them should be fully convinced in their own mind. The issue here is about our identity in Jesus Christ. Who are we? And I've harped on this for it to you a bunch of times. This commandment really brings it out. These are all times and places where Jesus himself or his apostles could have affirmed the Sabbath, but they don't. So what do we do with this? Well, there's a theology part of it, last part of building here. In the Old Testament, we had to talk about holy places. That's why when Moses says, take your sandals off, you're in front of this burning bush. This is holy ground, okay? You had to talk about that in the Old Testament. There was the temple, the Holy of Holies, Mount Sinai, places where God showed up. That was holy ground. And you can profane holy places with ordinary work. So if you were doing work on the farm and it was a holy day, the Sabbath day, you could profane it, okay? But in the New Testament, we don't talk about holy spaces since the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. We talk about holy time. How do you spend your time? And Israel in the Old Testament should remember and observe a holy day. In the New Testament, Israel is to live holy lives every day. That's where this is going. Holy time. So the theme of all of this is all of our life is worship. Every minute of every day, it's not just one day. This is different because it's public or corporate worship. And we can do things together as a body that we can't do individually. But everything you do is supposed to be an act of worship. Now, this doesn't mean that previous generations, you know, we throw them away. What we do in the Reformed tradition is we find out where we're wrong, we reform it, and we move on. They had their beliefs. It doesn't matter. We're always striving for reforming. So let's get into this now. The negative force. Don't misuse your time. And how you spend your time illustrates your priorities. So I want to talk about extremes first. So there's the slothfulness, the sloth who ha, ha, ha. If you know that movie, you know what the joke is. What's the name of it? Zootopia, the people who are at the DMV were sloths. How funny, right? Ha, they made a joke and they'd laugh, ha, ha, ha. Slothfulness is one extreme we want to avoid. Hours on video games, social media, computer use, Facebook. And then you can do other things in there. Sports, spending hours doing that, drugs, whatever it is, anything that's harmful, right? The other side of it is being so busy that you're overscheduled, so you have no time for anything. Your work is your life, and that's another extreme that we want to avoid. There's a middle ground. You have to be wise in your schedule, but you also have to have time to be able to think of the work of God in your life and how he has worked on you. So that means worship, prayer, reading the word, kind of those basic things again, fellowship, receiving the sacraments. So what happens if you fall asleep during the sermon? Do you fall asleep at work? What are you telling God is your priority? I'm pretty sure you're on game for work, unless you're able to sneak a nap where nobody knows in a closet or something. When God speaks to you in worship service and you're asleep, what are you saying about the fourth commandment? This holy time is not that important to me. Now, I get it. We're a busy culture, and you're all going around 100 miles an hour, and this is the first time you sit down for 25 minutes straight, right? And when you do, what happens? The eyelids become 5,000 pounds, and they start to close. The fourth commandment is telling you, you should prepare better for Sunday morning than that. Sunday is not an afterthought. It is the first thought. And then the rest of the week is built off of that. Holy time. So if you're so tired and I don't even know how I'm going to get to Sunday, right? You got to change your schedule because Sunday is one of your priorities. Or it should be, unless you want to break the fourth commandment. So, in sum, don't use our time or engage in things that are inconsistent with holy living. That is the negative force. Don't use our time or engage in things that are inconsistent with holy living. Make sure you get that down if you want to write it. Now to the positive force. So we should be intentional with our time. We should use our time wisely and in a holy manner, especially in regards to worship in the church. Sunday morning is the last thing we often think of when we're scheduling our week. But in this time, as we think about how we manage our time, we should be developing trust in God and dependence on Him. Now, our rest is in Jesus Christ. Why? 2 Corinthians 5. We are new creations. So what was tied to the Old Testament in remembering Genesis 2, there's a fall in Genesis 3, and creation has been under that curse ever since, but Christ is redeeming. And because we're new creations, it's in Him that we find our rest. So it becomes about holy time, serving the Lord, serving His people, loving our neighbors, praying, reading the Word, worship, since all of our lives are to be worship. So should I still have a Sabbath? That's kind of this question out here. Not really, unless you're going to Sabbath, quote unquote, every day. What you need to do is manage your time in a holy way. There's nothing wrong with making Sunday the church day. Nothing wrong with that. But don't make it legalistic. Yes, you are free in Christ to go out and grab some lunch. Yes, you can go swimming on Sunday. Yes, you can even dance on Sunday. I don't want to see it, but you can do it, okay? Forbidding playing or any of that kind of stuff is too legalistic. And you're not really a great witness to the world by hiding the antennae in your roof, even though you're watching TV on Sunday, when you say you shouldn't watch TV on Sunday. All of our lives are to be worship. So the positive force is this. We should always use our time in ways that are consistent with holiness. Remember that we live before the face of God, and everything you do, He sees. There's no hiding from Him. So as we think about this, we are new creations in Christ, and our time, how we spend our time, shows us who we worship, who we follow, and what's our priorities. Anybody know the name J. Vernon McGee? Pretty well-known Christian evangelist. Wrote several commentaries. Craig, you know him, right? So he has this really interesting story. He was confronted by a man who said, "I'll bet you $100, Mr. McGee, if you show me where the Sabbath has changed in Scripture." Now, J. Vernon McGee said, "I don't think it has changed. Saturday is Saturday. It is the seventh day of the week, and it is the Sabbath day. And even though calendars have changed over the years and cultures and all that stuff, we can put all that aside. The seventh day is still Saturday, and it is still the Sabbath." So the man looks at him and says, "Well, Mr. McGee, it looks like I got you in the corner. You should probably pay up right now. Why don't you keep the Sabbath, Mr. McGee, if it hasn't changed?" And McGee answers, "The day hasn't changed, but I have changed. I've been given a new nature in Jesus Christ. I am joined to Christ. I am part of the new creation. And we celebrate the first day because that is the day He rose from the grave." And then, of course, all of our life is to be worship. So therefore, anyone who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. It has come. The old has gone. The new is here. And all this is from God, who reconciled us to Himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God is reconciling the world through Himself, not counting people's sins against them. So as we attempt to love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our strength and all our mind, a holy use of our time is where we can start. It shows our barometer of our maturity and our priorities. So give all of your allegiance to God, commandment 1, never putting any other supernatural forces beside Him. Worship the Lord in spirit and truth, commandment 2, never misrepresenting His nature. And always protect and defend God's majesty, commandment 3. In commandment 4, we always use the time given us in holy ways, every day of every hour of every minute of our lives. For all of our lives is worship, and we belong solely to our faithful Lord and Savior. Every day, every hour, every minute. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, this is a complicated one, but it's freeing. Thank you, Lord, for the work of your Son. Thank you, Father, for our Lord and Savior who is making us new. And in this commandment, we get just a taste of what that really means in the new creation. By the Spirit, Lord, give us strength to guard our time. This week may be the first week for us to be holy in our time and our scheduling so that the holy things of our limited lives on earth are our priority. Thank you, Father, for your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand in response to this. Just a reminder, we'll have some cake together, and then Heidelberg class will start around, I don't know, 11 or so. We'll figure it out. It's supposed to be a little bit more, relaxed. So, receive a blessing from the Lord from Romans 15. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and use your time wisely.